folks. In this segment, I want to talk to you about how you can get more control over feeder generation and performance modeling. Now, feeder generation is one of the most important capabilities in performance modeler. It's intended to really reduce the learning curve to make you productive with TM1, but also to save you a lot of time. Rather than creating every expression with an associated feeder and working through that manually each time, it's intended to obviously support you as a modeler and make things happen a lot faster. Now, in almost all cases, Performance Modeler will write you a very efficient, tight feeder based on the expression logic that you've added to the queue. But there are cases where you may want to fine-tune and optimize that. There are other cases, certainly for folks who have come from Architect, they already understand feeders and have perhaps very large models where they don't want to take the risk of an inefficient feeder being created, where they'll want to turn that off and have complete control. So we're going to take a look at all of those examples here. Keep in mind, most of these you don't really need to work every day. It's just something that if you do have a problem or a specific preference, I just want to show you how to use that. So let's get started. So the simplest option to explain at the highest level is how we interact with the instance of TM1. So this is a particular instance of TM1 that I have. And the default for how we generate feeders is to only generate them for automatically generated rules. So that is rules which have been created with a cube calculation, a link, or a dimension calculation will also have an associated feeder generated with those where necessary. This setting controls that, and this is our default. If we wanted to be able to write manual rules and have Performance Modeler interrogate those manual rules and write feeders for them, turning this up to all rules would enable that. To disable feeder generation entirely for the whole instance, I would set this to no. And then I'm going to be responsible for every calculation, every rule being properly fed. At the next level, there are really two settings that are going to be affected. So if I take a look at this cube and I scroll down, we'll see a setting for require feeding of rule-derived cells. That will always default to yes, although for the purpose of feeder generation is overridden by that higher level setting we just looked at. Setting this to no will change two things. So first, no feeders will be generated automatically that target this cube, whether those are intra-cube feeders or inter-cube feeders. None will have this cube as target, although obviously some could be created here which then target other cubes, which you might frequently see with smaller assumption cubes. The associated behavior is that that will also disable skip check being set on this cube, so the cube will calculate in its entirety with that setting at no. So if you're wondering, do I have to set that for every single cube where I want that behavior? And the answer is no, although I would again caution that this will disable skip checks. But if I'm working with a very small model that I like to play with and don't really need to worry about feeding, I can do that very simply from a control cube. So if you take a look at your control cube for cube attributes, and we'll do a new view off of that so that we can work with it, and you'll see where these values are stored and retrieved. So easily for me to disable this for all of them. I'm actually not going to do that. I have a number of cubes here that do need to be fed, but I could simply do a quick shortcut there and turn that off for all cubes. That will require me to close and reopen because we've of course loaded this setting on startup, but that will apply that setting across my cubes. So that covers our high level settings and how we can control what Performance Modeler does in terms of preventing feeder generation. Let's look now at a case where we actually force feeder generation. So let's look here at a very simple project planning cube that I have just begun with a simple expression for spend percentage, which is the life to date spend on a project versus the overall contract value. So how much have we burned down that particular contract? And we'll imagine for a second that I want to create a remaining spend percentage, which is simply the inverse of that, how much value is left on that contract. So I'll create a new cube calculation. I'll call that my remaining spend percentage.
And I'll make this both an N and C level expression, so one expression for both. I'll also change the scope. I have a number of versions here, but I want this to apply to all of them, not just my 2014. And let's think about how we'd write this expression. So typically it'd be something very simple, which is just 1 minus my spend percent. But if I try to apply this, I'm going to get a warning telling me that this expression can't be fed. And if we look at the message, it actually makes a lot of sense. The expression itself would return a non-zero value even if all of the cells and all of the values were zero, because we're using a hard-coded number, we're using 1. So 1 minus 0 is still 1. So this value would require feeding the entire cube space. We don't want that, and performance model will not do that. It will just throw you this warning. And you might think, well, this is a very simple feeder for me. I know I can write this because I only want this calculation to happen where I have a spend percentage or I have a spend value. Do I now have to go write a manual feeder for that? Well, in fact, you don't. A very simple alteration to my expression logic will save me having to do that. So first, I'm going to take the value that I want and put that in parens. Then I'm going to multiply that by the item that I want to feed from. So I don't want this expression to happen unless I have a contract value. So I would say multiplied by contract value over itself. Now we know that contract value divided by itself should return 1 in any case where we have a contract value. So we'll either be multiplying by 1, or if it doesn't, that would yield a 0. Now performance modeler understands exactly how to feed this expression and will use that contract value. And if we want to take a look at that, we'll just minimize again. We see our remaining spend. Now let's take a look at the associated feeder. So N level remaining spend percentage. Here's our expression. And now if I scroll down, here's my feeder. So feeding from contract value to that remaining spend percentage. And I didn't have to manually write that myself. We generated that correctly. Now the last tip that I will show you is in fact a very last resort. I would not use it in this case, and I would not use it in almost any case where performance modeler is generating a feeder that for whatever reason we don't like. My first approach would be to write the manual rule and the associated manual feeder. However, it is possible to disable a specific feeder for a specific calculation. So in this case, we have the proper feeder being generated based on the expression logic I've added. Again, that will work in most cases where we're not seeing the feeder that we want. We just need to multiply by the item that we want to feed from over itself. But in those very specific cases where you need more control, I could add hashtag at no auto feeders, and that will prevent performance modeler trying to feed a specific expression. This is done in the rule editor using the commented line that you see here. But because I've done this as a manual comment, there is no control in performance modeler over that. So if I were to then delete this cube calculation, that line will remain and it will apply to the next expression in the list. So in terms of maintenance, that's a really dangerous addition to make to your model logic, because if you forget to delete that line, you're potentially removing a generated feeder from the following expression. So I really caution against that. There are lots of ways to get around these problems. If you're seeing a feeder that you don't like, that should be the absolute last resort. So those are my tips for controlling feeder generation in Performance Modeler. I don't want to leave off without mentioning how easy it is to generate a report about what the feeders that Performance Modeler is trying to generate will look like. This will give you a great and detailed analysis of the fanout and the construction of all feeders in the model that would be automatically generated. So this isn't going to happen for any manual feeders that you may have already written or added later. This will only cover generated ones, and you can in fact run this report without letting Performance Modeler apply any feeders. So disabling at the root level feeder generation and running this report will show you those that would be created. So for an extra level of review before feeders are generated, this is a really nice approach to see what's going to happen. So thanks for your time and happy modeling.